Hello, and welcome into Full Screen Podcast. I'm your host, Kira Aster, and joining me today, as always, finally considering signing up for Peacock now that we have a streaming release date for Oppenheimer. It's Raven Ebert. How are you, Raven?
I wonder if there's metrics that Peacock will run for Oppenheimer's release coinciding with the number of subscribers going up. And Amazon will be like, hey, there was a spike of adult toys being bought on this particular release date as well. Isn't that crazy? Anyway, how's it going?
Are you really excited about signing up for the eighth most popular streaming service in the country?
I think it's seventh.
It's in Paramount.
It might go up thanks to Oppenheimer. Yeah, I think that Universal making that deal with Nolan coming in for sloppy seconds after
Paying off. Good for them.
He's dumped Warner Brothers, so I'm pretty sure that Universal wants to keep him happy and will comply with whatever he wants in terms of streaming release dates and proper compensation for at least himself. I don't know if he looks out for his cast, because I famously heard stories about him not letting people sit on the set. I think it was Anne Hathaway who brought that up, where he doesn't allow people to sit.
Is that true, though? Because I heard the same thing about Bradley Cooper. I mean, Bradley is basically
Yeah, and they're both the equal caliber of directors. I mean,
it's clear. Also, he's been like crying in all of the interviews. Just Michael Mann, he was like, you sent me a rejection letter when I applied, you know, when I auditioned. And Michael Mann was like, yeah, no, I send that to everyone. Bradley, get it together.
Bring back bullying is all I'm going to say. And you know what? Bring back bullying from skilled comedians. Because if there's any reason to give up Dry January, it's being forced to sit at the Golden Globes with jokes that are just
transition.
Missing. None of them hitting. All thrown at the target and not one sticking.
Awful. The regular cringe that we're used to from Golden Globes was not... This is our first episode of the year. Happy New Year, everyone. Happy New Year, Raven. It is... The Golden Globes were kind of normal this year? Where's the scandal? Yeah, SAG nominations are where the scandal is at. It's reversed, which is going to be amazing. There were a lot of snubs, as we know, from SAG nominations. They completely ignored May December, which, nah, bro.
Well, I mean, calling out predatory relationships, maybe Hollywood doesn't want
to. And just looking at the craft of acting as well, Natalie Portman looking in the mirror and just kind of it doesn't portray her in a good light as well as an actor in the film, as an actor.
I think the most scandalous thing from the movie, of course, is that somebody who had a job at the CW can go on to have a successful acting career. Congratulations to Charles Melton. You are this generation's Michelle Williams.
I did want to quickly say Golden Globes 2019 ratings were 19 million viewers. This time around, it was under 6 million. Still better than pandemic era Golden Globes 2020, and I think they were in 2021 as well. And this time they were on streaming, and they were on Paramount, I believe, and CBS. The word on the street is that CBS is probably going to renew Golden Globes for the next year. So we'll see. Award season, you know, we're in it. But let's get to today's show. Let's recap the social media for the folks if they want to send us Paul Giamatti sightings at In-N-Outs.
No, leave Paul Giamatti alone, by the way.
This is his campaigning, Raven. Let him take his photo.
Let him have his In-N-Out in peace. I love you, Paul Giamatti. You're the only reason that I gave a shit about American history, because the John Adams miniseries on HBO is really good. Send me your Paul Giamatti fanfiction on Twitter and Instagram at @fullscreen_pod. If it is a slash fic between Reader and Paul Giamatti, That's my preference. You can also send it to us at fullyscreamed@gmail.com for the long form fiction. And of course, don't forget to follow us on YouTube at Full Screen Podcast. Like and subscribe, as all of the YouTube people say. Help us game the algorithm and subscribe to our channel, like our videos, leave comments there for future suggestions, episodes you'd like us to expand into new topics, anything you'd like us to give our hot or even ice cold takes on, we're here.
So our listeners know we go super deep, profoundly deep into topics, but this series that we've started, Metrics Minutes, is medium deep, I'd say. We recap some facts, figures, some numbers from the industry, and sort of bring the tech mindset of looking at impact and success. For today, we're looking at the importance and impact of the holiday box office. Why is holiday box office important? Why does it matter? What are the holiday box office trends? We're going to talk about the history. We're going to talk about 2023. We're going to talk about maybe our predictions for the future. So bring your Qualtrics and Adobe dashboards. We're about to get into some figures. You ready?
Let's visualize that data, baby. Let's go.
So what does the holiday season box office typically look like? So let's talk about what is the holiday season. So first weekend of November kicks off the holiday season for the box office and goes into the first weekend of January. People might not know that. And sort of bookended by, it's a term, industry term, dump months. Look it up. Capital D. Capital M, dump month. And January, Feb, August, September, they are, even September now, are sort of dump months. So you can see like leading into spring and summer, coming off of spring and summer and leading into the October, November, December timeframe. And dump months is when historically we'll get things that don't perform well, the studios are like, just put them out there, you know? Or recently we've seen just straight to streaming releases. What was interesting that last year, Megan came out in January, became a huge sensation. Magic Mike, I believe, came out in Feb. Ant-Man also, well, we can understand why Ant-Man came out in Feb also, you know, dump that content in there. But these performed pretty well, you know, in the box office, with Ant-Man especially, not in the cultural zeitgeist situation.
Oh, everybody was making Megan slays of the box office puns for weeks and weeks. You know, the idea of dumping, I would say that now that we have streaming, there used to be the term of
it's
like...
fading.
Yeah, the direct-to-video quality that we used to talk about before in movies to disparage it. Now it's like, it goes direct to streaming.
It's, we were talking about Sweeps Week off mic. That idea has also faded with streaming. But, so what is the holiday season, why is the holiday box office season important? So we hear the phrase holiday legs. Sometimes when we talk about later in the year releases or read about them in movie publications. So movies continually doing well beyond their opening weekends during the entirety of the holiday season is basically called holiday legs. So it comes out, you know, Wonka came out Friday on December 15th. Let's say, I don't know when it came out. And it's going to continuously do well throughout December and into January. And that's termed the robust results at the box office during the following weekends. That's termed holiday legs.
Holiday legs are when I refuse to shave mine because I'm not wearing anything that shows any skin above the ankle like a Victorian lady because it's the winter and I can get away with this.
That's just winter legs. That's legs from October to May-ish. And then legs don't go away. You know what I mean? Get some sun on those legs. Holiday season typically does very well because it's quiet time. Everyone is together, friends, family, cousins. You are looking for escapes, obviously, so you can't talk to people.
You're tired of watching the Hallmark Channel on repeat at home.
And this acts as, this is why summer releases also do well. This is sort of like the summer vacation, schools are closed. But holiday season is kind of a step above that because offices and workplaces are closed too. So everyone literally is together, not just the kiddos.
Well, summer means you get to go to the pool or the beach and do things outside.
There's other distractions, yeah. And then I will say there's a compulsion that happens, which is very task-based mindset. So as the award season kicks off around this time, people start campaigning. This time around, it was very strong because the strikes ended and everyone was out on in full force talking about their projects. But people start to sort of take stock of, okay, this I haven't seen, and the calendar, the sort of like calendar December 31st, I have to complete seeing these movies that my friends are talking about or that I read reviews about. Let me get this done while I have time. So there's a compulsion to sort of like check off things from your to-do list.
I have a different compulsion in the streaming era where I love the communal feeling of watching movies. Having conversations after the film itself, I love getting that communal IRL feeling of being on film Twitter, if that makes sense. We represent the two sides.
100%. Only two kinds of people that we represent. You know?
That's it. Yeah, there's no other types are valid. Absolutely.
So all of these factors lead up to a massive bump in the box office as so many people can finally go to the movies, and whether it's to get the IRL film Twitter experience or compulsion to check off the things from to-do list, massive bump, right?
So if we look at this from a product perspective, right, the first step is knowing your audience. You set the context of who is going to the theaters pretty well. This is a time for families coming together, so it's people of all ages. People are looking to be entertained and they have different needs. So it's usually movies that cater to a variety of different tastes, like, you know, blending of different genres or things that are generally family friendly. I would say PG-13 is still considered to be family friendly. Again, because contextually, if it's more focused on violence, then I can still see people getting blown up while sitting next to grandma, as long as the camera doesn't pan over to like their charred corpses. So it's no surprise that what we see in the holiday box office is usually big budget movies that are specifically catered to check a lot of the boxes for different genres. If we look at what was number one at the domestic box office for the last 10 years in the holiday season, we see Hunger Games representations in 2013, 2014, and 2023. So, you know, you have the intellectual property of the Hunger Games coming back. It's historically done well. The first two movies came out more than a decade ago, and they also did very well at the box office. I believe Catching Fire, the second one, was the highest grossing out of all of them, and have been doing really well because the core demographic of the young adult readers are from break on their schools, and so they can go watch it with their friends. Of course, let's not forget my man Big Jim. Avatar comes in 2009 and 2022. This spectacle of seeing all the special effects. I think the 3D conversion in 2009 was also pretty decent. So a lot of people went to see it and did not throw up, as far as I remember. But it's got that broad appeal. Plenty of animation also represented. Who can forget the whole nation covering their ears while kids struggle to sing like Idina Menzel for two consecutive decades, with Frozen and Frozen 2 both being released at this time and doing gangbusters at the box office, of course. Wide appeal animation. There's also The Grinch from 2018, which I also went to watch because they got me with the Tyler, the Creator soundtrack. I was just so intrigued by the idea. Yeah. Also, you know, the big boys, I would say Spider-Man No Way Home, of course. In 2021, it was supposed to be like the savior of cinema. Everyone's coming back to the theaters to watch this. And, you know, well done to the marketing team for that as well. Thank you, Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield, for coming in and contributing like 66% of that box office take. And Star Wars used to be big in the holiday season. I find it interesting that Episode 7, Rogue One, and Episode 8 came in and did gangbusters at the box office. And we're conspicuously missing Episode 9.
It was rough out there. I will call out all of these that you mentioned are mostly above $2 billion in the box office, the global box office. Avatar 2009 actually closer to $3 billion.
Oh yeah,
it's made guys
unreal money. Like, it's not real money at that point.
And Titanic, most notably, again, Big Jim, and the Twilight series, as well, notably in the top 50 grossing of all time, also came out around the holiday season. So, cool thing to know.
Yeah, I have very fond memories of watching New Moon on Thanksgiving with a certain ingenue grabbing my hand every time Tom York played. Ooh, it's Tom York! Yeah, we really were great. Like,
this Cedric, is a- Cedric!
Once again, my apologies to the women behind us at Regal Cinema 16 in the Atlantic Station. I ruined your night, and I'm sorry about that. Anyway, but I think, again, like, if we're looking back in, like, in 2022, we saw Black Panther, Wakanda Forever, Spider-Man No Way Home, and Avatar Way of the Water was, like, released around this time and still made it to the top 10 of their year. So even though mathematically you think there's less time in the theater for them, they still compensated with the holiday legs that you talked about, where people go out and see it, and positive word of mouth is very, very important in this particular time, because those morning and matinee shows that I talked about, that's for people who really want to see the movie and don't want to risk the possibility of not being able to get a ticket during like the night showings and stuff. So I think, again, it's usually PG-13 is the most mature, and I haven't seen a ton of comic book movies like we talked about with Marvel. They seem to focus on the summer side and not in the winter. Like, it's been
Avengers most notably. Yeah.
Aquaman, the first movie, did $1 billion being released in December, and the second one is struggling. Again, I think that's not necessarily because of the quality of the movie, but rather what it represents in the larger zeitgeist of the DC continuity. People who really care are aware that James Gunn is coming in and putting in his own universe, and that this story ultimately goes nowhere. And so people feel like, oh, there's nothing to get invested in. And then, of course, the last prong of what we're talking about, what's in the box office, are the awards contenders, right? The streaming services put them out just to meet the requirements from the Academy around how much time a movie spends in physical theaters to qualify for the Academy Awards, and not really concerned about driving the profit. And independent movies are also starting to understand that they can do well in the box office. Like A24, for example, one of the most cited examples of, you know, successful independent film distribution and production companies, they're also not limiting their awards contenders to be just released during the winter. Famously, Everything Everywhere All at Once was a summer movie. So it's possible to have awards legs still throughout the year if you get good words of mouth, if you get people excited about it. Critics do pay attention to people positively responding to independent cinema as well. But of course, like, a lot of what we're seeing dominating the award season are recent releases. I mean, like, what is the oldest release that you can think of that's been making the award circuits right now? I would say Barbie and Oppenheimer, right? And those are massive blockbuster movies that weren't quote-unquote award contender movies. Like, they were made to make a lot of money at the box office. That's why they were
commercially appealing.
Exactly. Yeah. And they just happen to be very well-made movies, so they're getting recognition. So I think we're still going to keep seeing this time period of like January to March being ignored, because who wants to go to the movie theater at this time? People are still sort of
not this year because of the strikes. Dune comes out in March, which I wanted to talk about.
Well, historically, this has been a dumping ground, but I guess there's been...
Well, John Wick came out in March last year, or April, I can't remember.
Mm-hmm, because it's an independently financed movie that can do really well. The Batman also came out March, that's not independently financed, but again, I think these are recent paradigm shifts that have happened because... of streaming, and we'll talk about that a little bit more
topsy-turvy.
In terms of like what this means, like what the box office numbers. So we've like taken a look at what we're seeing, we've seen the trends. Let's go into where things are moving towards.
What does the 2023 holiday season box office tell us about the future? So according to Scott Mendelson on The Outside Scoop, he's a great analytical mind looking at film industry from a perspective of data. The total domestic box office for the final weekend of 2023 was around $119 million, up 13% from last year's New Year's Friday to Sunday gross of about $104 million, and up 20% from the $99 million end of the year weekend from 2021. So we can see a steady rise throughout as we come out of the pandemic era, from $99 million to $104 million to now almost $120 million. Interesting to note, I was also listening to a Yahoo Finance you know, we do our research.
You took a wrong turn somewhere in the internet. You were like, let me go to Sephora. Oops, I'm on Yahoo Finance.
Listen, their SEO for when you look up film data really is high. So good for them. Some numbers around the Thanksgiving weekend. I know we've been talking more about December, but up 40% year over year. 2023 Thanksgiving weekend 5-day frame was around $172 million at the box office, and last year it was about $122 million. And then just comparing that to, let's say, 2018, pre-pandemic, $315 million. And then let's look at 2020, right in the middle of the pandemic, $21 million. I will say one of the larger points that Scott makes in his piece and points out as a reason to hope, basically the box office gross has not been that much. A reason to hope is that there's a lot of movies coming out and a lot of movies targeted at different demographics, which is what you were hinting at before as well, Raven. So, quote, "It's proof amid a relatively strong earnings for films as varied as Wonka to Ironclaw to Anyone But You," shouts to Anyone But You, "that the difference between a healthy COVID-era theatrical marketplace and one on the brink of extinction was about merely having enough movies. So 584 in play in 2023, 584, versus 440 in 2021, but compared to 854 in 2017, good God, for the theaters," end quote. Just the sheer volume of movies being out there is a reason to hope for box office recovery. And after 3 years of being underfed in theaters, the 2023 calendar year ended with a bang, because finally there was something to watch for everyone in this season. So I just want to recap some of the figures from holiday releases. So Wonka, a big huge hit. Shouts to Paddington, Paul King. Yeah. 500 and as of today, 505 million globally at the box office. Godzilla Minus One came out of nowhere, performed really well, 94 million for what it was, right? Iron Claw, Jeremy Allen White, Zac Efron, just
love the flipping of the billing. Jeremy Allen White comes first. Someone's bear bias is showing.
27 million, doing pretty well. There's a big, I think the word of mouth again, holiday legs for this are pretty strong. Boy and the Heron, Miyazaki, 149 million. It's either 149 or 340 million. I think I messed up my numbers in the doc, but you know, it did pretty well.
Do you think Miyazaki gives a shit about money? He's out here to make art. And Art is hearing Robert Pattinson goon into a microphone playing a heron. God, oh my God, with
he
teeth.
Was terrifying. terrifying. Anyone But You is kind of a signal that rom-coms on the big screen are kind of slowly coming back. Just comedies in general and romance in general and rom-coms lacking, as we know, lately. But 65 million globally, the word of mouth of this movie is really great. It has great young hot stars, Glenn Powell, Sydney Sweeney. I can't wait to see it. I haven't seen it yet, but this is totally
apparently amazing. It ended relationships. The chemistry is too hard to ignore. Nathan Fielder and Emma Stone are trying to replicate this energy in the most cursed way, pun intended. I'm glad to see that, but I think again we'll just get like the one landmark rom-com for the year for the next couple of years. I don't think we're gonna get a glut of them like we did before. Maybe we're ramping up to that, we'll see. But I think with the success of the studios maybe willing to take a risk with a mid-budget rom-com being released.
Sort of the absence of superhero content as well. There's room for other genres to rise up here and make a return. Before I pass to you, Raven, I did want to call out. So, of course, because of the Twin Strikes last year, the 2024 season box office will definitely be affected. We've already seen Dune get a weird release date, March 1st, as of now. I think the date was the first holiday weekend last year. It was supposed to be for Dune 2, but now it's March 1st. There's Twisters, which is going to be a big tentpole by Lee Isaac Chung, starring Glenn Powell. It is, based on the IP, but Lee Isaac Chung is such a great name attached to this because Minari... as an auteur taking on Twisters, incredible. So this comes out in July. If nothing moves, we never know. And then Furiosa starring Anya Taylor-Joy, which is related to the Mad Max IP, is slated for May as of now. I will say I'm not hopeful because as of a few days ago, my most anticipated movie of this year starring Our Pats by Bong Joon-ho, Mickey 17, is indefinitely delayed. Gone from the calendars. It was supposed to be May 17th, but now we don't know. So we'll see. We'll see how it does.
I just feel like these are good numbers, but we're still recovering from 2020. And we're also recovering from all of these studios scrambling to make original content for streaming, which of course means less resources for things being put out theatrically, right? Like Correct. We've got Universal scrambling for stuff with Peacock. We've got Paramount Studios scrambling for Paramount Plus. I don't know if Warner Brothers Discovery is making content or just having fun canceling everything, but I assume that they also put money aside to make some things for Max. I feel like we're going to continue the streak of major movie studios putting out intellectual property and franchises one after the other. And new stories, exciting cinema again is going to be done with independent studios that are relying on good word of mouth, people who are excited about genres being blended. A lot of people, I can recall anecdotally, who are not horror fans, went to see Talk to Me because it was so hyped up by people who just enjoyed the experience of seeing a well-made horror movie in theaters and said, you gotta go check this out. And a lot of people also said, oh, it's A24. They're, you know, they make good movies. So I think that independent cinema in terms of appealing mass audiences is doing very well right now. Yeah.
Yeah, 100%. A24, we love A24 as we know, but it's A24 kind of leapfrogging to mainstream popularity has really created room for all these other studios, independent studios, to take its place. Neon with Anatomy of a Fall, which I would say probably my favorite movie of last year, if people haven't seen. Eileen, we know Parasite was Neon, I have to say, if people haven't forgotten. There's Ferrari, which, I mean, how independent is Michael Mann?
He's pretty independent. But yeah, again, like, you're absolutely right. More people also feel encouraged to do stuff that gets people talking, gets people excited by word of mouth. So, but I think from big studios, it's just going to be bankable, dependable franchises, which also I feel like there's a lot of scrambling that happens there because, the superhero fatigue has started to set in. The box office returns are telling a very specific story about audiences reacting to incredibly long storylines that are spread across like multiple movies and franchises. So maybe there's going to be some streamlining happening there. We'll see. I'm very happy to see The Color Purple having done well. Mean Girls having a good showing at the box office. For those who are not aware, the current Mean Girls is a movie adaptation of the Broadway adaptation of the movie. So 2004, yeah. The movie was released, it was made into a Broadway musical, and then the Broadway musical has now been adapted into a movie. So that's a 30 Rock joke, right? Like, that is literally a 30 Rock joke. I don't think we'll see a ton of musicals coming on. We know we have Wicked, of course, so it's just going to be very recognizable Broadway properties that keep coming to the movie theaters. Maybe that's going to be encouraging. The other thing that I took away was that now that we're giving away awards to people who make money at the box office and musicians also like getting awards, we're going to see more and more people do theatrical releases for their concert experiences, right? Because if you can't go see them live, go see a concert in the movie theater that you can maybe see multiple times. Like, Olivia Rodrigo is going on tour, so I imagine that she could also similarly do something akin 100%. To what Beyonce and Taylor Swift have done. I know Blink-182 and Green Day are going on tour, not together separately, but that is something that I would definitely go to see in a Hot Topic hoodie at a midnight showing. Bad Bunny is so huge. I bet his concert tickets and his tour is going to be insanely successful. He could do that.
Fresh off his Kendall breakup, so you know it's going to be raw music.
And I have a really bad, horrible feeling that 30 Seconds to Mars may also try this, because I don't put anything past Jared Leto trying to get attention. So
there was a dark time that I would listen to them and run every day on the treadmill, and I was like, oh yeah, feeling
well. I think it's good fuel to run away from, for sure. And I just found it very interesting now that you're given awards for making money, but once upon a time awards were given so that you could use it in your marketing.
It's a different world. Yeah,
it is a very, very different world. I think the awards are good for maybe building people's individual careers instead of necessarily making the movie money. So campaigning and pushing for awards and stuff have a completely different agenda, and I think that also is shown in the types of movies that are considered awards bait or awards contenders. So
I differ slightly on that, because I think about the award season and the celebration of the industry. I always think about people are not going to tune into these awards, which are very important for discoverability of content and stories. So you need a balance of like, okay, no one's heard of this amazing movie and we're gonna nominate it to like shine a light on it, or and also nominate people, you know, movies and people in those movies that people are attached to, so they tune in. And I don't know if that's like wishful thinking, if we're gonna ever get there, but in my mind during the awards season, when I look at the numbers, I always think that like people haven't heard of it. I mean, we know they nominated Barbie basically for that box office award at Golden Globes just so people would tune in to see Margot Robbie and Ryan. Okay, shall we wrap here for today?
Decoded everything?
Do we understand?
I'm working through my seasonal depression by yelling about numbers with you at the box office. But find independent cinemas if you can and watch the movies that you want to over there. They're very much driven by public demand. So if y'all don't want to see Wonka anymore, they will remove it there.
Go see this little kid named Timothée Chalamet before he becomes big playing Bob Dylan, you know?
God, I thought you were going to say little and then I pictured you saying Hugh Grant.
Little Timmy!
I thought you were talking about Hugh Grant looking dead in the eyes and saying "Je suis Oompa Loompa" or whatever.
Oh my god, that press tour. Incredible. We are so blessed. Anyway, let's wrap here. And for next time, we are talking industry tech roundup, YouTube originals, what went wrong.
I'm sorry, guys. It just the vibe changed when Kira found out it was Daddy Google.
Coming
down the pipeline.
Until next time, full screeners. Bye.
Bye, everyone.